I was in school. I had just finished my coursework for my doctoral degree, and I had a headache that just did not go away. It impacted school, it impacted work. I was taking something every 4 hours. Like, whenever the next time I could take something, I was taking it.
For me, it was this sensation of confusion with exhaustion, intense nausea, and throbbing head pain.
A great day for me is a day that I don't have to take any medication, and I could just get up, take the girls to school, after work, take the girls to softball with no pain. And a bad day would be not being able to get up from bed. So my 9-year-old tells everyone, shh, mommy's having a migraine attack. Even the dog just stands still.
Migraine is estimated to affect up to 40 million Americans. About 25 to 30% of women will experience migraine, and about 9% of men. It's considered by the World Health Organization to be among the top causes of disability. When you add up the number of days that someone is disabled over a lifetime, and then you multiply that by the number of people who have migraine, you start to see just how important this is as a public health problem. Our understanding of migraine has evolved substantially over time. Migraine is such a characteristic disorder that it was recognized in antiquity. There are very clear descriptions of migraine in ancient Egyptian writings, for example. A lot of the ideas about migraine reflect the society in which they were developed.
I'm getting so weak.
In the last century, migraine was principally considered a disorder of nervous women. Many of the treatments that were employed were sedative medications. The idea that migraine was psychological was highly prevalent. However, once effective treatment for migraine was developed in the 1960s, it became a little bit clearer that perhaps migraine was in fact something that was biological. And of course, this came in the context of changing attitudes towards women. Women have entered the workforce. The disability produced by migraine is more obvious and has a financial price tag that perhaps was hidden.
Research has really changed our perception of migraine. It's much more than a headache. It's a brain disease. There are different theories about what causes migraine, how it's evolved. In recent years, we've honed in on this neuroinflammation and this pathway in which neurons are activated and triggered and cascade into the central areas of the brain.
Migraine exists along a spectrum of severity. There are people who have only a couple of attacks a year, or maybe only a couple of attacks during their lifetime. And then there are people who have daily or near daily headaches. The vast majority of people with migraine are somewhere in the middle. Migraine is a condition that has many genetic influences. This genetic tendency to have frequent headaches interacts with environmental triggers, both internal and external triggers, some of which are under a person's control, others of which, like hormonal fluctuations, might not be.
For me, it's the head pain, sensitivity to light, sound, smells. With migraine, there's like this self-blame aspect of like, what did I do wrong to cause this?
You know, I would get questions like, can't you just take something? Or there must be something in your diet that you're lacking.
It's not always the case that you have a headache because you did something wrong. Sometimes you have a headache because just your internal threshold for having headaches is low, and sometimes it's breached.
Hello. How are you? Good. Nice to see you again.
I think the most important thing for doctors and patients to realize is migraine is a chronic illness.
Now we understand that it needs to be treated, it needs to be managed, just like we manage high blood pressure and diabetes. And I think that's been a turning point.
I'm excited about where we are in terms of understanding migraine and by the momentum that I see. Today, there are treatments that can help reduce the number of attacks. and treatments that can be helpful in stopping the attack or making it much less severe. But it can be challenging to find the one that works reliably for someone. One of the things I think we don't understand very well about migraine is with any particular treatment, there are people who do beautifully and have a wonderful response, and people who, for all intents and purposes, seem to have exactly the same sort of headaches who don't respond at all. I often tell people that treatment is a work in progress. And that's not a cause for pessimism. That's the way it is with any chronic, multifactorial illness. There's no one-size-fits-all treatment. The treatment plan needs to be constantly reevaluated and sometimes changed over a person's lifetime. People who are suffering and are disabled by migraine deserve to feel better.
I've learned to correct people when they say, "Oh, you have migraines?" I say, "No. I live with migraine disease." Even that small thing, it helped them understand. It's like, oh, that is different.
What are you taking my cookie for?
For me, it's been a journey of acceptance. My focus isn't how do I get migraine out of my life, and it's more how do I live my life with migraine.